In modern day racing, downforce plays a huge role in the success any given car will have. A prime example is the world's most watched racing series, Formula One. Since the hybrid era, which began in 2014, lap times were getting continuously better, especially since the huge advancements which were achieved in 2017. The amount of downforce a 2016 Formula One car could produce were relatively small in comparison to the 2017 descendants. 1 year later, lap times again experienced a significant drop, even though the straight line speed was drastically lower than in all those years before. However, it turned out that generally speaking, the more downforce a car has, the better it will handle common circuits. Of course, there are some exceptions like Monza or Spa, but a racetrack usually has more corners and, more importantly, straights, which are not like 80% of the whole track. So, since we nailed down the capabilities regarding engine power, or rather straight line speed of all cars in a Assetto Corsa competition, it is now time to find out which car has the best aerodynamic package. As I mentioned before, a decent race car needs to have both a powerful engine and also a capable aerodynamic package. Or you hire Adrian Newey as your head of aerodynamics. In that case, a half decent engine is enough to be competitive. Anyway, how are we going to determine the amount of downforce a GT3 car produces? Well, first off, calculating the maximum amount of downforce a GT3 car in ACC produces is a hell of a lot of work to do, and b, probably going to be very inaccurate, since we would need to measure the wingspan, chord, and also a few more variables which are next to impossible figuring them out. After all, we would probably get a fishy result which tells us the amount of downforce in Newton. So instead of saying wing and splitter on settings 6.6 produce X amount of Newtons, we are going to measure the impact on straight line speeds, and can therefore make statements like wing and splitter on setting 6.6 slow you down by X amount of kilometers per hour, which is far more understandable and comprehensible, in my opinion at least. So, to get something going, we first need to throw all formulas out of the window and seek out a base where we can start our research. And what are values we already measured and have a decent feeling for? Right, the top speeds from the last video. And since downforce comes with a neat side effect, which is increased air resistance, or in racing terms, increased drag, it also has to influence acceleration and top speed, right? Basically, the idea now is to run the same tests as for the top speed experiment again, but once with the splitter and rear wing at 50%, and then at the specific maximum settings. According to the laws of physics, this should slow them down at least a little bit. With this said, our job for this test is to find out how much of an effect the aerodynamics play on each individual car. So here we are again at our good old French circuit, which still no one can pronounce correctly. Same starting point, same straight, different setup. Yes, I'm aware the track can also be produced by bad aerodynamic properties or a bad chassis, but we are assuming that this is not the case here, and even if some teams messed up their car aerodynamically, it should level out. If a chassis is bad, it should already have been noticeable in the top speed test. Before we start, let's go shortly back to my last video, where I'm explaining how different variables are measured. Every car will be stationary at a set position and then accelerate from the beginning of the straight right to the end, where the top speed is going to be recorded. To measure the acceleration, I am going to use the in-game timer. The displayed time will be taken at the frame the first throttle input is registered, and also at the first frame which displays 100 km per hour on the digital gauge in the bottom right of the screen. after what felt like the whole summer holidays, testing is finally finished and I'm ready to present my results. So let's see how much the cars in ACC are affected by aerodynamics. And before we dive into some nice graphs, let me just say that the aerodynamic settings did not really affect the acceleration at all, whether from 0 to 100 or from 100 to 200. The maximum difference was just short of 3/10 of a second. But let's move on now to the results. First of all, here you can see a graph where all top speeds are present with different wing settings. The bar on the left represents the according top speed with the lowest wing settings, the middle one with intermediate wing settings, and the bar on the right shows the results when the wing settings are maxed out. But since these bars are rather messy, I went on and made a second graph which directly shows the differences in top speed in kilometers per hour. This time, the black bar shows the difference of the intermediate settings compared to the lowest settings, and the blue bar represents the difference of the high downforce setup to the low downforce setup. And lastly, here are all cars with the individual max wing settings, which are represented in yellow, and also how much kilometers per hour one wing setting will cost you in terms of straight line speed, which is displayed by the blue bar. In the end, I hope you could take something with you and enjoyed the video. And as always, if you have any remarks, questions or suggestions, you can leave a comment below. Cheers!